Hello, everybody. It's going to be this session is going to be a full session. So these are exceptional times, and I trust you're all taking care of yourself and your loved ones. The subject of rethinking business, especially in these times, is a very heavy subject, especially because the context is still emerging. So how can we talk about rethinking business in a situation that's so fluid and so dynamic? However, it's very important that we talk about this subject, very important, for the purpose of using our current knowledge so that we can understand what are the changes in the reality that is surrounding our lives and surrounding also our businesses. Why do we need to do that? So that we can increase our chances to survive and grow as individuals, but also to survive and grow as business people and as business organization. The context of this conversation is, of course, about business. If I need to summarize in three words, the main themes of this talk is going to be three words: observe, prepare, and experiment, and maybe at a later stage, integrate. So we need to pay very good attention, because business is an important part of our life. I mean, Freud said life is about love and work. So for him, work was at least 50%. So even if it's not 50% for you, at least work is an important part, because that's how you put food on the table for you and for people who work with you. So it's very important that we look at business in these very turbulent times. In the end, to put this in perspective, it's really going to be about three main questions. Question number one, should you stay in your current business or job? That's one of the objectives of this talk. Should you stay in your current business or job? The second one is, if not, what business should you go to? The third question, if yes, then can you stay in the same kind of business, or is it time to change your business, considering the current changes around us in our reality? So I would suggest that we pay very good attention. And if you have some notebooks, it's also useful, because I'm going to ask some questions that I'm also asking myself, so that we can, you know, ponder about these questions after we listen to this, after we have this session. The approach I'm going to take in this session is outside in rather than inside out. So I'm not going to start talking about your business, you know, and then from there talk about the external environment, external context. I'm going to talk about how the external context is constructing itself and how that in turn projects itself on your own business. So we're going to go from outside in approach. And I want you to bear with me, because in some cases you might think, why are we going into this detail about so and so and so subject? It's important, because what's happening is at multi-layer. It's a multi-layer dimension, and you can't live in a global environment if you can't understand things at a global level. So I'm trying to make it as relevant as possible to your business. This is not a dead time. Some people, I mean, we took the first few weeks to adapt to the shock that happened to all of us, but this is not a dead time. We might not be at our offices, we're at home, and we're trying to make things work as we are doing now with this talk. Right, because I mean, we don't have the complete infrastructure like we do in our offices, but it's time to do so much, and it's a very important time, because we need to prepare. This is time to prepare, to think. It's not a time, this is not a vacation, this is serious work. In fact, I think the extent and the intensity of work that has to be done by all of us now, business people, I'm talking about business perspective now, is maybe far more than we can do, we're doing in our offices, because at office is mainly, you know, operational and crisis management with some time for strategic thinking. Here is the time of strategic thinking when mega changes are happening around us. So there's a lot of work to do at home, and we have to approach it from this level. So I would encourage you to listen well, as I have listened well to all of this, and I've been thinking about it all the time. So I'm going to talk about a number of issues, then I'm going to start from the outside and zoom in And if you stay with me, then you will understand how all of this will translate into making sense in your business, so that it can help you to think about how you move your business onward. I'm going to first start by talking about the nature of systems. The nature of systems. This is not an intellectual conversation for no purpose. You can't understand what's happening now if we don't understand what's happening to humanity. You have to understand that so that you can understand yourself, because you're part of that. So the main question is, how will humanity, we're trying to predict now, humanity react under so much stress in this situation? To begin with, I would like to talk about what a system is all about. In very short, in brief, you know, briefly, a system is about smaller components that come together in an interconnected way to form our entity. Now, like a family is a system, parents and children. Organization is a system, management and all the workers. A country is the system of all the citizens. Humanity is a system. You know, the ecosystem in the planet Earth is a system by itself. So systems exist all the time, and they're subsystems, and they're part of reality, because we exist in systems. We don't exist as individual people. In fact, we exist in multiple systems. In this case, we're talking about the global system. Now, to understand the global system as a system, I can't think of something that's more complicated than this. And if anybody tells you, if anybody ever tells you that they really understand fully what's going to what's happening now and what will continue to happen in the future, you know, think again before you're accepting what they say, because nobody knows. Why nobody knows? Now, it doesn't mean that we should think about it. Of course we should, but nobody really knows. Why nobody knows? Because it's so complex to be understood, so complex. I'll tell you why. Because take the human brain. The human brain, as everybody knows, is the most complex, you know, organ in the entire universe. This is one person. And it takes many lifetimes to understand a person. And you could live with a person for, you know, 10, 20 years, and then in a certain situation, you can't even predict how this person is behaving. And many times you will be surprised, because it's very hard to predict individuals because of the complexity. Now imagine 8 billion, almost 7.7 or 7.8 people connected together at multi-layers. Why multi-layers? Because we have, you know, we have the physical layer, and that's under threat now because of the coronavirus. We have the intellectual layer. We have the spiritual layer. We have the social layer. There's the psychological layer. There's the emotional layer. There's the cultural level. There's the political layer. So you name it. And I can go on and on and on. And all of these are not just interacting horizontally. They're interacting vertically as well, and in all that diagonally and in all directions. So trying to predict something as big as and complicated as this entity, trying to predict the behavior of this is next to impossible. Now, does this mean that we should sit at home and wait until things are clear? No, I'm not saying that. On the contrary, this is the time to observe. But let me give you an example. Before World War I, how did World War I start? One person was assassinated in Serbia, right? And what happened out of that? The entire World War I thing erupted, and millions of people died. Take another event. 250 or 300,000 people died in a tsunami. Nothing happened to the world. I mean, in general, of course, there were damage in that country or those countries, but the world continued. Let's take the United States. Thousands and thousands, tens of thousands of people die every year in the United States because of crime issues. Take 9/11, 3,000 people died in World Trade Center, and that event changed the world. So it is completely impossible to predict how something as complex, as big as the global community will react under so much stress, because this is unimaginable stress. It has never happened like this in the entire history that at least we can study and refer to. And there's something called emergent outcomes. What are emergent outcomes when you study systems? Is an outcome that just out of a sudden emerged without any expectations, or just out of the blue, because things have been piling in the background without people noticing and then suddenly erupted. So all of this to say is that we're dealing with a very complex, complex nature that requires not being passive about, but being super active and working seriously hard, more than you work at home, so that we can at least start to figure out how it's behaving. Because based on that interpretation, we will increase or decrease our chances of survival and growth as a business entity, but still too early. So what can we do? What are the action points? Number one is keep watching the developments. Keep watching everything. Just follow the news. Now, while you're doing that, you're following the news, make sure that you're not overwhelmed by single news. Because the nature of media, especially when it's sensational, is that they take a subject, you know, the hottest news of today, and everything becomes about that news. Now, if you stay with that, you will be overwhelmed. So what you do is that you watch the news, watch what's happening, but you also go back to see how things look from the big picture. And the mechanism, the term I use for this is zoom in and zoom out. Zoom in and zoom out. Zoom in to look at the at what's happening as events and developments, then immediately zoom out to see how they fit in the larger picture, right? And watch for the for signals of trends. And sometimes they're very small signals that they're not very well covered by the media, because media goes by the flavor of today or the main event of today. So you have to watch for these small signals so that you can at least imagine a trajectory, a trend that's building up, so that you can make sense of this. And continuously adjust your frame of thinking, your frame of vision. And once you're doing that real time, because this is an emerging and developing situation, then what you could do is start planning. Don't have a plan, but stop at least the planning phase, because the plan is static, planning is dynamic, and act accordingly later on. But remember, this is not the time to now act immediately, right, and make super strategic decisions, because it's still not clear. It's completely, dynamic. So what you need to keep in mind is now is just to remain adaptive, as much as you can adaptive. What to do in this situation? Let's remember, number one, is that our ultimate purpose is to survive and grow. That's our ultimate purpose. As organizations, now we're talking about business. As businesses, the challenge is how do we survive in this, dramatic change that's happening to our current reality, right? And how do we plan and how do we make sure that we continue to survive in the foreseeable reality? And how do we make use of that in terms of opportunity and grow? But the main challenge now here, my friends, is just to survive. So let me be very frank with you. If you now come out of this safe and sound as a business, not just as a person, of course, first priority is you and your family and loved ones, to make it as health-wise, to make it physically and stay alive. That's what counts. It's more important than everything else. But business is not less important, because it puts food on the table for you and for others. So the main challenge now, you will be a hero. You will be a hero as a business executive, as a business owner, if you come out of this alive. Why? Because the variables are unlimited and the situation is so dramatic that and it's open-ended. I mean, who knows what might happen? I mean, as it might, we're talking now easily in July, August, we're talking now, if everything's goes well. If there's another surge of this virus, then, wave two, then we're talking about going back to the same situation in November and maybe after that. So it's very hard to survive in this situation. So if you can survive as a business entity, whatever your plans in job, professional, whatever that is, then you are big time a hero. And that itself is a major development, because survival depends on fitting in a current reality. And our current reality now is changing dramatically, right? So survival, especially business, your survival as a business is under threat, and adaptation is needed, and adaptation is not easy when we don't know what to adapt to. So that's why we have to be careful, we have to be vigilant, and we have to keep watching what's happening. This is not a time for a vacation. Watch everything so that you know what to adapt to. Growth also depends on the opportunities in the current reality. It also depends on the opportunities that will emerge in the future reality, right? What potential will the future reality, as we come to a new normal, as to a new reality when things stabilize, because we are now in a complete state of chaos and disequilibrium, what will the future state of relative equilibrium offer as opportunities? And some of that are clear. I mean, look at the hygiene industry now. They're having an opportunity now in this chaos, and probably in the foreseeable future, they have more business opportunities to expand and sanitation and other and many other industries. So now is the time where your capacity to adapt and evolve are being tested, and this is not an easy thing. This is going to be, my friends, a test of your character, a test of the resilience of your business, a test of what are you made of as a business person, as a manager, as a CEO, as an investor, as an entrepreneur, as an employee. And maybe equally important, if not more important, what are you made of as a person? Because this crisis well, it's a major crisis, will show the best of us and the worst of us. Because the amount of stress, although you feel that, you know, it's not horrific, because it's not, you know, dramatic, no, people don't have guns, you know, pointing to you, but the fact that you're sitting at home with your family and you're worried about any person you interact with, don't underestimate the level of this stress. So this is heavy stuff. Now, being in a state of crisis does not justify lowering the quality of what you do. Now, you might have, for practical reasons, lower the quantity of what you do. Of course, obvious, because people are not in their jobs and, you know, we're trying to manage as much as we can in terms of productivity from our homes. But this is a message for all of us and for our teams. Crisis does not mean lowering the quality of your performance, regardless of the quantity. And especially when it comes to exercising leadership. On the contrary, this is the time where the best of who we are should come to the surface. Because guess what? Employees are watching you. So this is a time to inspire them. This is time to be the strongest person in the entire system, in the entire group, in the team, in the organization, in your society, in your family, right? When you talk about business, this is time to be for you to be the strongest person in that entity. Because people are watching you and they will either be inspired by you or you will provide them with a bad example and they will imitate and mimic that example. And you don't want that. Your bosses are watching you. Your colleagues are watching you, not in a judgmental way. Well, maybe in judgmental afterwards, because when we think about that later on and how everybody thought about how to, everybody acted, you know, judgments will form. That's human nature. But we're looking, people are looking at you for clues on how to react because nobody knows. And when you're in a position of authority, business owner, CEO, manager, whatever that is, right? People look at you for clues on how to deal with all this uncertainty. Your colleagues are looking at you because they're scared, right? Like you're scared. And they're looking for inspiration. So what you do counts. The market is watching you. The market is watching your resilience as a business, your behavior as a management team, and as you know, as the top of this organization, the decision maker, your behavior as an organization, your capacity to adapt, the quality of your work, the true values that are manifested in your current action. All of this is being tested under pressure. That's why I said this is not a time for complacency. This is a time to be working much more than you're working usually at in the office, because this is deep, serious work so that you can survive in this exceptional times and you can prepare yourself for the opportunities of what might be coming. Equally important, and I really want you to think about this, remember how long it takes to develop a brand. You know, it's an entire lifetime to develop people's perception about your reputation, which is what the brand is all about. People are watching your brand, and your brand will be dramatically shaped by your behavior and your behavior of your company and your colleague during this crisis. Whether with each other, right? If you lay off people, then people will think about, you know, question marks about your loyalty when it comes to committing to your people. The way you treat your clients, all of this. So your brand is on the table. So how will you deal with your clients, and how you'll deal with your employees? That's a big question, because the way you do will determine your reputation for many years to come. It's very important now, my friends, to stay as calm as possible, not passive, but remain calm, especially when you're in a decision of, you know, when you're in a, you know, high level, you know, in high place in the hierarchy, when you're a decision maker, stay calm, observe as much as you can, keep observing, reflect as much as you can. Take notes, have a notebook, reflect on your ideas, you know, stand by the window and just think and meditate. We have time to do that. In the past, we used to complain, there's no time for strategic thinking. Well, now, much of the time is for this kind of reflective thinking. So think about that. Analyze, interpret, prepare as much as you can, experiment as much as you can within the limits that you have, you know, new ideas, new ways of doing things. And take your time to decide. Again, take your time to decide. If you have to make a decision because of operational reasons, go ahead and do them now, because not doing them might undermine your survival. But when it comes to big decisions, take your time to decide, because it's still unfolding. You don't know. You don't want to commit now when you're half informed and we're not well informed, and when things has not really stabilized, you don't have visibility. It's dangerous to take strategic decisions. I have some people who told me, Now they discovered, you know, how beautiful it is to work from home. So maybe, you know, we should close our operation now from a, you know, tangible perspective, have an office and move to working mainly from our homes. You know, and if you have regional offices, maybe you don't need our regional offices. Maybe you should do that. But what I'm saying is, too early to take those kind of decisions. Why? Because it's easy to make choices. It is easy to make choices. You can even be impulsive about making choices. But it's very hard to, it's very hard that, you know, to live with the rest of your life with these choices. Because when you make a choice, that's easy. But the hard part is to live with the consequences of your choices for a long time. To think, but don't rush into a decision unless you're ready for it. Unless you really, you really want to make that decision. Unless you, unless you're under pressure to make that decision. Right? If it's strategic level, don't make that decision now. I'm going to talk now a little bit about globalization. As I said to you, I'm going to start in outside in. Huh? And we have to talk about globalization. Now, this word might be frightening to some and might be ambiguous to some. I'll tell you what it means, a very simple word. And then I'll tell you how it's relevant to your business, even if you have a very small business, medium to medium, small to medium size, is still important. I'll tell you why. We have to think about what's happening to globalization. So the meaning of globalization is really simple. It's about moving manufactured goods or services, you know, and moving funds and moving people and ideas and information around the world. So in an ideal, totally globalized, you know, economy, you can start a business, a factory anywhere you want in the world. You can get the funding from any other place, other corner. You can get employment, you know, people from another place, and you can get financing from somewhere else. And borders, I mean, virtual borders will be open so that you can move all of these and do business globally. This is, of course, the ideal situation. But in principle, that's what globalization means, is to turn the whole world into one global market where you can move, do, and do things easily. Hmm? So why should you care about globalization? Because globalization defines the rules of the game. You can't do export and import. You can't do trade. You can't do production. You can't do investment, finance, right? Without thinking about understanding globalization, because it all depends on the nature of the global economy and the market. Acting in an open market, you know, is different than acting in a closed market. When there's protectionism, is different when there is, you know, more liberal economy and open borders, right? So the rules and regulations that govern the way we do businesses on a global level or even of a regional level are important. And it's important that you think about them and you reflect about and you observe how will the COVID-19 virus, the crisis, affect globalization, because it will have implications on your business. Very few businesses now are locally dependent, because at least on this, even if you have a store, you know, a neighborhood store, at least your supply chain has to in some way or form be linked to what's happening in other parts of the world. So this is really about you. So how will COVID-19 affect globalization? Big question. Another big question. I'll try to go into this. Please pay attention, because it's really important. It has, you know, it has a large dimension to consider. Number one, it's very hard to make accurate predictions. Now, it's easy now for me to say, I expect this and this and this to happen. I can say that, but that would be dangerous because it's misleading and there's not enough information when the situation is dynamic and unfolding to make this kind of prediction. So it all depends on the crisis, on the depths of the crisis, on how dramatic it is, on the extent, and how all of that will manifest itself, you know, in shaping what comes afterwards. And this is not the first time that globalization is being shaken like this. Remember, if you were in business in 2008, there was a financial crisis and a similar thing happened. What's happening now, it shook the world for years. What's happening now, multiply 2008 by multiple times. The IMF, I was reading yesterday, it said at least two or three folds bigger, considering the visibility that we have. Now, if this goes into October and November, then we're talking multiple and multiple other folds. So we really have to watch that. And the main lesson that we have so far gained from this is that globalization is vulnerable. Doing business in a global, at a global level now is vulnerable. Look at tourism, vulnerable. Look at universities, especially those who depend on expats, vulnerable. Aviation, Hollywood, frozen, you know, entertainment business, hospitality, hotels, and much of the services center is all vulnerable. All of this now has been dramatically hit by what has happened to the global market because of the coronavirus. So we're really vulnerable to this. So, and we discover that what happens in one part of the world, affects what happens in the other part of the world, on the other part of the world. And it also exposed the risk into the supply chain. China closes, then we have problems in our, you know, in the supply chain of our factories. India closes, we have Vietnam closes, the same thing. China, for example, used to be in 2008, you know, occupy 4% of the global economy. Now it's 16%. Another thing, look at globalization. The issue of confiscations. Now, because of what happened, you've heard the story of what happened with 3M, how 3M was instructed by the US government, because there's an emergency situation, that all its product has to go first, you know, serve the US market. This is a major interruption. There were agreements done. There were people paid money and they were expecting that, and they had built business plans, and more important, the healthcare plan based on expectations of these products, but completely now diverted back to the US, because of course the US has to save its own people. So these are an emergency situation and rules are changing all the time. I also heard the story, Spain was importing ventilators from China, and the shipment stopped in Turkey for some time for refueling or, you know, some kind of logistical step. And then when the Turkish authorities knew that this was about ventilations, when they knew it was about ventilations, they decided to confiscate this and they took them over. And the Spanish people, the government objected, but the Turks went on. I don't know what happened, but you can see the kind of interruptions that's happening. So we really need to look more about how do we rely more on our local supply chain? How do we rely more and about our local supply chain to avoid these kind of interruptions? This will definitely be on the table after we're done with this, because we've learned that, you know, anything of this kind of that can happen, and who knows what might happen in the future, right? There's a mega interruption. So can businesses take that kind of risk? Now, this has happened, started already before, huh? When it started, when we're starting relying more on the printing, you know, 3D printing. And the purpose of that was to have production more close to us rather than, you know, a complicated supply chain. When automation was on the increase, when customization was on the increase, when we demanded more quicker delivery, when there was more and more talk about protectionism. So all of these things were already on the rise. Meaning that, you know, reshaping the supply chain. But now COVID-19 has dramatically increased that, and I expect that all this supply chain world has to be reorganized all over again. The way you import your, you know, who manufactures your product, how they come to you, and where is the raw material and the entire thing, all of that has to be put on the table and redesigned all over again, so that we can learn from this and prevent against these kind of major interruptions. So what are the expectations for globalizations? There are two ways of looking at this, and now we're going into a deeper stuff. One way is to expect that whatever happened after World War I in 1918 to happen again. After World War I, we went into more nationalism, more protectionism. There was an economic depression, right? So there was much weaker international organization. This is how the world went into after World War I. And World War I, compared to this kind of, you know, this kind of environment, this kind of crisis is relatively smaller, although that was also huge, but smaller than this scale. On the contrary, what happens after World War II in 1944, we went on the other direction. More cooperation happened, more internationalism happened. You know, we created something like the Marshall Plan, where the United States, mainly United States, contributed to rebuilding Europe through the Marshall Plan. That's part of internationalism. The Bretton Woods Agreement that regulated, you know, the monetary policies. We created the United Nations, and we created also the General Agreement on Trade and Services, and trade and tariffs, the GATT. All of these came after 1949, which is a complete opposite to what happened after World War II. So what we're learning from this is that after major events, things can go in any possible direction. Now, the main issue, my friends, here is who's going to lead what happens afterwards? You know, when coronavirus settles, who's going to lead the direction of where globalism right? And globalization is moving. So it depends on the mindset that will govern the leadership mentality that will make an influence on that. And as we can see now, unfortunately, there's no leadership coming from the White House, understandably well, because, you know, they have a major, serious, mega-level crisis at home. So now they're focused on home. China can't step up to this challenge because they don't have the scale. UK can't also step up to leading at least Europe because they already, you know, after Brexit, it's completely different things. And now, you know, the European Union is community is destabilized and was still trying to find its way into equilibrium after Brexit. So there's nobody at a huge mega level who can stand at an international level and influence how globalization that will influence your business is going to go. Now, some good signs happened in the last G20, where they decided to have a stimulus budget of $5 trillion, you know, to jumpstart the global economy again. Now, this is the global economy, the GDP of the global economy is around 85 trillion. People, experts were expecting that we need from 8 to 10 trillion dollars, at least double-digit percentage-wise from the global GDP. What we had was 5 trillion. It's still very good. It was better than the pessimist expected. I personally expect that, you know, if things became worse, we might have another injection of more funds to globally, especially by G20, to help the economy start again. And this already happened in 2008. At the time, they gave up. I mean, they decided on a $1 trillion stimulus package. But now, of course, the scale is different and the needs are different. So this is a good sign that they decided on $5 trillion. The U.S. decided also locally. Of course, that includes what already has been decided. You have 2.3 trillion in the U.S. You have 1 billion by the IMF. And in Germany, it's about 800 billion. France, Italy, everybody, you know, the big fives are deciding on. Australia has decided on 9.7% of their GDP is going to be used as a, you know, as a stimulus package. But still, the issue of leadership, who's going to lead the G20? And obviously, is the U.S. is the biggest economy, is absent now from the international scene because of the obvious reason. Now, what's coming also, and that's also important, my friends, to think about, is that the U.S. election is coming. So who's going to be in the White House after November? And what's going to be the mindset of that person? And if it's going to be Trump, will Trump be the same Trump after, you know, coronavirus crisis? When he starts his new term, if he was re-elected, or there's going to be somebody else with a completely different mentality. So that's also another variable that will decide on how globalization will move, and that will have a direct impact on your business, regardless of how small your business it is. Because as I said, the context of this is to start reading, observing things so that we can think long-term. You can't wait. It's not a vacation where we can wait now. You know, nothing to do, just get bored. And then when everything is settled, we go back to drawing board and think. Now, that would be too late because people are at home and monitoring and thinking. And that's what will make a difference between who's going to, you know, come up with minimum damage and who's going to come up, you know, with more opportunities in the future. Let's expand a little bit on this. This is a hot subject. I'm going to expand a little bit and I'm going to go deeper, because it adds to the perspective. So please stay with me. Forgive me if this is turning to be complicated a little bit, but stay with me because it all makes sense. So let's expand a little bit on this. I see that the world, that's personally, I see there are these following challenges that the world now is facing. Number one is the health challenge, and now that's a priority. So everything stops, and everything, all the money, resources, everything, attention, leadership goes towards dealing with this, which makes sense and it's understandable. The second one is the business setting. And as soon as this, you know, health challenge will be over, immediately we'll go into the business. And Trump keeps saying this. The reason I'm referring to Trump because, you know, the impact of U.S. in the global economy. So Trump keeps saying this, we have to go back to work. We have to go back to work, of course, but after we make sure that people are safe and sound. The third element that will come to this is local governance, because now there's this big question mark with this kind of mega threats happening to humanity. Can the world, can countries, can governments, can society rely on their private sector to deal with them? Obviously, they can't. You can see how, you know, the shortages of equipment and how people are how people are struggling with, you know, how to handle things on a local level. So maybe what will happen, not maybe, most probably, government will step up and say, you know, part of the healthcare system will be under government management because we cannot afford to go through the same thing again. We have to take more control of the healthcare system locally, So I expect that happening. The other thing that will happen, there will be more invasion on issues of privacy and individual freedom. As you know, and it will be justified for quote-unquote health security reasons, and maybe that makes sense, right? But that will also start another debate, human rights and other issues, right? And so imagine now, many countries have hundreds of millions of cameras in their streets watching people, and they have this sophisticated, you know, face detection mechanism. Imagine with artificial intelligence now, this evolving to become not just face detection. It will capture your temperature, body temperature. It will capture your pulse rate. It can even capture the way your eye pupils, you know, either eyes are diluting or contracting or opening up, right? To capture, to understand more what's happening to you and then to analyze it from a health perspective. Now, that makes sense, but there are other implications of that. Because when you have so much control and understanding how people feel and the way this is related to how people are, how people think, then you can understand that you can understand the impact on that you can understand the impact of that on issues of individual privacy and individual freedom, because the governments will know more about you. And of course, this is dependent on the variable of what. Which variable? The variable of the local governance that existing now. But for sure, all government now will ask for more powers because of, you know, the reason that next time they will be more prepared. There is also an issue of global governance. And now we're talking about geopolitical issues. And I want you to bear with me because this is super interesting. This is really, really super interesting, at least to me. Now, if you observe, and I was having a conversation with a friend of mine, a professor, her name is Wafa. So we talked about how the level of trust is going really down. People are distrusting each other. The fact that you're at home, it means that you distrust that people outside are a danger to you, right? So, and this distrust is becoming bigger and bigger and bigger and bigger. People are wearing masks, and this is becoming integrated into part of, you know, our psychology and sociology. And then it will become an anthropological also dimension, and this has to be studied. So people are distrusting each other. People are distrusting their governments. Governments, local government, are distrusting their central, the federal government. And countries are distrusting each other, especially when, you know, when we start doing things like, you know, interfering in the way the supply chain, and we're asking companies not to honor their contracts with other countries, you know, with masks and other issues, and bring them back home. So it's all distrust now, all distrust. So you, so many countries have now, you know, ordered equipment, you know, bulks of ventilators, but now they're worried that they might be confiscated. So all of that is based on mistrust. Now, if you really think about this, you go deep at a psychological and sociological level, and you think at a global level, you know, have a real, real universal and global perspective. This is super serious because cascade distrust, and you have an entire global community that's distrusting each other. Not only distrust, let's take it one step further. It's aggression. When you say to people, stay 2 meters away from me, this is a sort of aggression. It's soft, but it's aggression. When you wear masks and you're suspicious of other person, you know? I remember a case where it was on social media. Somebody sneezed in an airplane, and he got beaten up by, you know, many of the passengers, although there was not even, you know, evidence that he had the virus. So distrust is building. Now cascade this onto the different layers of how the world is structured, especially, you know, politically. So who knows what might happen afterwards? And this will translate into big questions. Some are going as, and big intellectuals and big thinkers are going into as far as thinking that there's going to be a completely new world order after this happens. We're going to go into a new world order. And valid question marks, will Europe stay the same after this? Will Europe stay the same? Already after Brexit, other organizations other countries were already deciding or thinking about, you know, going separate on their separate ways and separate and, you know, splitting from Europe. So will Europe be able, under the stress of all of this, that will take years and years and years, you know, to manifesting itself? Can Europe stand this? Some people went as far as saying there's even threat that, you know, the United States itself will be fragmented in terms of state. Personally, I don't think this will happen. I think this is too, people are going, to extremes, but you'll never know. My personal opinion, the social contract in America is stronger than this. I don't think that will happen, but at least you can think of the divisions in the way that this is impacting the internal divisions within the United States now at many levels. I mean, look at the model that, you know, New York is doing, and look at the model that, you know, Florida is doing. So this will all start debates, and it will definitely manifest itself on partisan level. They manifest itself in the way election will be translated, and far, far beyond that. So people are talking about this from a perspective of having a global impact, and we have to watch this. Now, are we going too far? Are we going too intellectual in thinking about this? I don't think so, because this will translate itself. This will translate itself in what? This will translate itself in globalization. This will translate itself in trades, in protectionism, in rules and regulations of how communities and societies and countries interact and do business with each other. That's why we have to keep this in mind. And I expect there's going to be more tension between the two, these main global ideologies, globalism from one side and nationalism from one side. How this will manifest itself? It will manifest itself in the following way. Number one, there will definitely be attempts to create more cooperation. Why? Because of four practical reasons. We will have to at least get together and coordinate practically to make sure that we can deal with the coronavirus thing in a more effective way, because of local interest, at least. Even if you don't have a globalist mindset, you will have to coordinate. So there will be tension, one force that we need more coordination. But at the same time, there's going to be a continuing mindset, right, that was prevailing before December 19. It's going to be prevailing before December 19. And this mindset will continue to expand, to continue and maybe accelerate. Who knows? But logically, that's what it looks like. The U.S., I'm asking you, will U.S. change its orienting philosophy after this? Can you see Trump having a different mindset, right, after Corona? It might, but the way it looks like, it's highly improbable. Do you see China not becoming China after COVID-19? I don't think so. Will Russia's, Putin or become a different person after this? Also, I don't think so. So this mindset will continue, and the risk that it will go even in a faster way, in the way they were going. So we'll move more into nationalism, and this is the tension that I have been talking about. Now let's take it even deeper. This is really, more serious than even what I've said. The humanity now is going into a huge cultural shock. We're going through a huge cultural shock at a humanity level. All humanity now is traumatized. We all feel, 8 billion people feel vulnerable. Or we discovered that we have been overconfident in science, especially in medicine, in the pharmaceutical world. You know, one virus, look what it did. So there's a trauma at a global level. And media, of course, is making this worse because it's bringing all these together to our living room. So you're not only witnessing your own personal trauma. You have dozens of traumas every day. Look at the traumas of the nurses. Look at the doctors and all the post-traumatic syndrome that will go through for years and years to come. So will we forget after a few years? Maybe we'll forget, but we will never be the same again. I'll just give you a dramatic example. Let's say somebody was raped, and I apologize for this dramatic example, but I have to use it. Somebody was raped. Now, after a few or 5 years, 5-6 years, the person might forget that incident. But that person will always be different because they will be suspicious, of any person that, might even indicate, give any sign that could be such kind of danger. You were attacked at night, or you were mugged in one of the streets at night. When you go again to that street, even if you've forgotten about it, you will be more careful about this. So we will forget about this, but definitely this has this has changed us. We discovered this shocking reality that we're once more eeny, meeny, tiny virus away from an existential threat, you know, from huge stress. Now, is this virus existentially threatening us? No, but it paralyzed 8 billion people almost, you know, billions of people, and it's claiming lives by the tens of thousands or thousands every day, right? So we're if a worse virus come up next time, then we're really under danger, and it looks like what we know about science now at least doesn't give us enough time to act immediately. So there will be time and there will be casualties. So we're one virus away. We're really cruising at the edge of chaos, as you know, as the term says. Another big question to think about is capitalism. Can capitalism stay the same after this? You know, when people have, companies have laid down from the first 2 weeks, 10%, 20% of their workforce, how will this be interpreted afterwards? Would you trust these things? Will we move from a stakeholder capitalism into a shareholder capitalism into a stakeholder capitalism, where not only investors are taken into effect, but not only investors, but also staff, also suppliers, also the community around you. So are we going to move into shareholder into a stakeholder capitalism? Big questions. I'm not very optimistic. There might be some refining to do that, you know, but this is also a question that will be put on the table and will be discussed in hundreds of books for years. Has globalization failed us? Has globalization failed us, as it seems now, from interrupting or disrupting the supply chain? Maybe it has, when some people say globalization was not designed for these kind of pandemics, but still, pandemics are reality, and it's going to be more of reality in the future, as we have been seeing the past 10 or 20 years, right? So we have to think about, will globalization be reversed? Personally, as President Michael Kouly, I think that probably it will not, because it's too important for it as a development to be now, you know, to be undone. We can't go there. I mean, it's too big to be reversed. Will it slow down? Yes, 100% it will slow down, right? Like capitalism, we'll have to, you know, adapt and, you know, refine itself because of what happened. But I don't think they will be completely removed. But will we go into a new kind of world order thinking about these things? Definitely we're going into that direction. To what extent, I don't know, but they can. Capitalism, globalization cannot be the same. So the big question, my friend, is, are we learning from this? Are we going to learn from this crisis and integrate into our thinking? Will we learn quickly enough to identify, control, mitigate, and regulate these risks so that we don't go into these kind of problems again? And can we incorporate and factor on all of these threats into our thinking of globalization? And this, of course, is determined by the extent of leadership that will be manifested, right? And the orienting philosophy that will dominate whoever is going to be exercising leadership. I took some time to talk about globalization. I hope you can realize, you can see with me how important this is, because it doesn't matter how small or business your big is, how big or small your business is, you're part of a global economy in the way you use your goods and services and you supply them, and you have to think about all of that. When do you have to think about all of that? Now, when you're sitting in your home and contemplating and observing all of these things. I'm going to talk a little bit now quickly about microeconomic trends, because also this will affect what's happening to your business and my business and all businesses, regardless of size. Will we have a deep depression? Yes, we'll have a deep depression. Of course, we'll have a deep depression. Now, some people say we'll have multiple depressions. I'm not sure, this is too much, but we'll have a serious depression. We don't know to the extent, because it depends on how deep the corona thing will be, because this is new to us, but definitely we'll go into the recession. The GDP, global GDP will reduce locally, global GDP will reduce, and GDP also locally will be reduced, because for months, you know, we haven't been producing a lot. Eventually, will there be recovery? Yes. Will it be fast and sharp or slow? We don't know. It depends on how long this takes and the extent of the damage. But eventually, yes, there will be recovery. Will be a V-shaped recovery? I mean, we're going down and then immediately we'll go up. I don't think that will be the case, because the because the scale is too big. So my thinking, from my experience, this is going to be a U-shape. But the bottom part of the U-shape might be a long one, but it's going to be a U-shape recovery because the scale of what is happening at all levels. It will take some time to go back to the previous levels of our global and local GDPs. Right? I hope it will be sooner than later, but definitely it will be sooner than the pessimist. I expect it will be sooner, but not very soon because what's happening is big. Will we go back to growth? Yes, we'll go back to growth because the fundamentals, some of the fundamentals at least, are still there. Right? Whatever the fundamentals of growth that were dominating, last October, November, before this happened, are still there, some of them at least. So I think that is an encouraging sign. We'll go back to growth. The U.S. election will have a big impact if, logically speaking, after this is over, Trump will do everything he can to jump the economy all over again, because that's an important part of how U.S. elections are conducted. So he will do, I expect that he will ask for more money than the $2.3 trillion. So the U.S. will try to go back into a V-shape growth. But I think because the scale is too big, it will be very hard to do that. And it will also depend on who's going to be in the White House. If Donald Trump was not there, what's the mindset there? But eventually, the U.S. is the biggest economy, and I think eventually the U.S. will manage to pick us up, right? Unless, of course, there's a second wave of a coronavirus happening in November, right, or maybe early next year, or maybe next winter, maybe if the vaccine will not work again, or a second, type of corona, who knows? But we have to watch all of this. I expect that there will be aggressive monetary and fiscal policies. Central banks have already reduced the interest rate to zero, and they're already printing money. The government is reducing taxes, and at least in the U.S. I heard that they might, because money is cheap now, zero interest, they will borrow money to work on the global, on the local infrastructure at the U.S. level, and this will pump trillions of dollars into the economy. So all of these things will happen. Some people have doubt if the fiscal and monetary policy will help or complicate things, but I don't see any way out of it. There are tools that are available and they're strong tools, and eventually I think they will be used. I expect that there will be innovations in technology, especially on 5G, and that a new generation of internet will happen, or an improved internet. It's absolutely a miracle. I mean, we're so lucky that internet has not collapsed considering the kind of demand. We're so lucky. So the lesson now is how to make it more robust, because we can't make that vulnerable. So a new generation of internet will show up. I have some concerns. There will be a concern about I have concerns about the global debt, because before this happened, there was trillions of dollars of global debt, and people are worried that if this blows up, then we'll go back to a major crisis. Now, with the trillions of dollars being now printed by the central banks and injected, the global debt will be increasing, and people will borrow even more, especially as low interest rate. There will be inflation because there's more money in the market. I expect poor countries will be poorer because the rich country will be busy with themselves, and the poor countries do not have enough resilience to stand up on their feet, as the big ones will do. Some losses will not be recovered because this is too big, but eventually, I think what's coming next, because I'm optimistic, in many cases I'm optimistic, we will build a more resilient economy. New outbreaks will be less disruptive, unless there were much more than the coronavirus. Competition will increase online and offline at a global level. Countries will have to invest more on IT infrastructure, so that if these things happen, at least internet and technology can keep at this part of the economy going on. Now, what changes do I expect in the business world? I hope you're still with me. I know it's too much and it's heavy, but it's an important subject, and let's put it all together and see how we can create a comprehensive view. So stay with me. Change in the business world, of course, the digital world will be enhanced. So we'll go more digital. There will be far more dependence on internet, which has to be stronger, and because we cannot make it vulnerable. 5G, I expect 5G to skyrocket, because it proved that we need to communicate. Artificial intelligence will go high. So all of this will be accelerated. And you know the impact of these events on acceleration. Automation will go up because we need to reduce the possibility of human interruptions and to the business and human disruptions. And many jobs will be lost by the millions. I don't know how, but I think eventually they will find their way back to the economy as we go back to growth. But there will be joblessness and it will be painful. It depends on the country and how resilient it is. Africa will be hurt more than Europe, for sure. Right? And the trends of working from home will increase permanently, but not as dramatically as people think. There will be more freelancing and there will be more outsourcing that will happen. The future will work. Will it change? Yes, it will change. Like hygiene will be an important part. Other aspects will be important part. But I don't think it will change so dramatically as people are saying. We're going to now forget about working together. We're going to work, online and Zoom and all these technologies. In the end, human nature has stayed human nature for millions of years. We need touch. We need connection. And I'm sure you're feeling like me, like many others, that we're looking for that moment where we can go out and mingle and have parties and visit our friends and loved ones again. So that will not change. Human nature will not change. We will remain together. Of course, there will be more integration of technology, but it will not change our human nature. Previous changes that have been going on will be further accelerated. HR will have to evolve. And talking about your business, because now we have to think about salaries, vacations, terms for freelancing, outsourcing. HR has to accommodate all of that, and it has to readapt and reinvent itself. Finance, very important, because it shows now the importance of financial resilience. So finance is important. CFOs and finance department will have to also rethink the way they do business because they have to factor in these kind of risks. Business etiquette will change. I don't think we'll be, cramming ourselves in joint meetings, at least for the short term. So shaking hands, the way we do business, all this etiquette will change for some time. Eventually, we'll go back to being how we used to be, eventually over the very long term. But we will remain more and more conscious of hygiene. Management style, of course, will have to change because we'll have to learn how to manage remotely. KPIs will change. It will be more about, management by objective, based on deliverables, based on efficiency, on coordination, on flexibility, on teamwork. Online business will grow faster. Online to offline will grow faster, as you can know. Delivery business will be faster. Social media will become stronger because it has proven its validity and importance now. There will be less manual work, relatively speaking, because of artificial intelligence and automation. There will be more innovations, much more innovation. I expect a spike in innovation, because especially in technology, to boost all the needs that we have now, 5G and communication, online business and the whole thing. So I expect a surge of innovation to accommodate this new reality. Soft skills will be in need, soft skills. Why? Because as you can see, you cannot leave it to artificial intelligence now to decide the fate of human being. Artificial intelligence cannot decide whether you should shut down companies or shut down the market or not. You need human judgment in this. So we need to develop a new wave, a new kind of leaders who can understand at that kind of level, experts in crisis management, and think at a wider level, because you can't leave this to the machine. Companies, industries like surveillance, I expect them to boom. Hygiene, healthcare, freelancing, all of this. And many businesses will have to reinvent themselves considering the new reality. I don't think many businesses will be obsolete unless the needs for the presence is changed and at least they fail to transform. But I feel many more businesses, most of them, they will have to more transform themselves than go that become obsolete, of course, unless they're poorly led and managed. Innovation related to hygiene will integrate itself into so many things, into design, into architecture, into food processing. So sanitation will become a major issue because people need to be reassured. Restaurants, hotels, all of these, will have to integrate an element of hygiene and sanitation. So that will go up. Anything that relates to increasing resilience will go up. Contingency, planning, related businesses will go up. Risk mitigation will go up. reorganizing the entire supply chain will go up. Now I'm going to go back. How do we think about ourselves? And I please, if you can, let's pay more attention to this, because now we're projecting all of this on ourselves. How do we do that ourselves? And what's going to be our orienting philosophy? Number one, is you have to remember that it's all about your survival and growth. It's all about survival and growth and how the current change is changing our reality in an almost cataclysmic way, but it's still going. So we're moving now from dealing with risk to dealing to uncertainty. And I was having a beautiful conversation with a very smart friend of mine. His name is Osman Ahmed. He's based in the US. He's a consultant and advisor. We're talking about the difference between risk and uncertainty. In risk, you know, most of the things are under control. Some of the things are variable, and you have parameters you can control the risk. You have now the general uncertainty. Now, how can you provide for that? You can't accept by observation. So you need to observe. You need to be more focused. You need to be more organized in your thinking. And you cannot do that if you don't observe and you focus. You cannot be stressed. Otherwise, you can't make good decisions. You need to prepare and have scenarios, you know, 3-month scenarios. What if this takes 3 months, 6-month scenarios, 12-month scenarios, and maybe even 18 months, and maybe this is too far. But you need to have these kinds of scenarios to make sure that you will stay in business when this continues, because we don't want to be 6 or 3 or 12 months. So you need to have these kinds of business scenarios. What happens if we, you know, if we're like this in 6 months, if we're staying at home? We have to have more imagination so that we can be more creative and more experimentation so that we can test new ideas to detect more, you know, to answer to more the changing needs. And we need to integrate all of this. So preparation, observation, preparation, imagination, experimentation, and then integration of all of this into our work. We need to observe how people's needs are changing, right? How new needs are emerging. And we need to go back. You need to go back to your most loyal clients and ask them, how do you want to be served from now on? Ask these clients. And maybe a good idea will be maybe to apply some, as Osman was saying, some design thinking now, which is starting by the customer. How does the customer want to be served? What are the needs there? Are there new needs? And how can we integrate all of that? You start with the needs, because the concept of the business has not changed. What's happening now, the environment is changing. Some needs are dead. Some new needs are emerging. And the current needs are manifesting itself in different ways. So we have to go back to that point. Ask, what are the needs? And then from that backward plan, you know, and reverse planning, and see how we can apply these needs. I want to mention now that my theory about how I understand things, and this is about the 3 P's, the purpose, the process, and participation. So for you and I, we have to go back, and now we're internalizing all what I've said originally, into our purpose. We have to go back to our purpose and ask ourselves. We put ourselves in the founder's mentality. What's the purpose of our organization? And then ask about the process. Does the previous process matter? Ask, how can I fulfill my purpose considering the new reality? What do I have to change to do that? And then talk about participation. How can we operate, act in a way that will make this happen? You know, the new process, the new way of thinking, the way of doing happens in this current reality. So we have to think purpose, we have to ask clients, and we have to act according to the new reality. We also have to learn how to adapt. And you to do that, eventually we have to adapt. So how do we adapt? You can use your SWOT analysis technique, you know, strengths, weaknesses, opportunities, and threats. That's one way. I use a different technique. You think more adaptively. So these questions you and I have to ask ourselves. What should we kept and protected from our current business? What proved to be a fundamental rock that cannot be negotiated, even under these situations? That's number one. What should we eliminate completely because we don't need to do it anymore? It was wasting our resources. What should we emphasize? What should we do more? Because in these situations, it can have more effect. And what should be downsized? That should we do less with? Why? Because it doesn't prove to be useful in this environment. So more importantly, what should we learn and acquire, you know, in terms of skill and abilities and technologies and processes that we didn't have before, so that we can be adaptive? to this new environment. So we have to think along these lines. But remember, it's too early to make mega decisions because the context is still unfolding itself, right? So don't act in a radical way. We're still at the beginning of this, or maybe halfway, but a lot has there's a lot happening, and it could change in many directions. Our understanding is incomplete. We need to, the primary focus now is about adaptation and survival, and no mega decision, just be ready, think about it, prepare yourself, and eventually, when you're ready, then you apply them. But now, just think about your survival, because that's what makes a difference. I'm about to finish now. I apologize if this took a long way, because it's a huge subject. I mean, the thinking, rethinking business in this context is a huge subject, so just bear with me. And dare to ask yourself the fundamental questions that I started with, you know, in these exceptional times. Do I really like what I do? Am I convinced of my business, or I'm stuck with it? Do I need to be in the same business? These are mega questions. And if I want to stay, how can I change my business in a way that it will stay a valid business in this environment? And to do that, we have to look internally. Think about your crush structure. Does it still apply in this new reality and what's coming? Think about your financial stability and the robustness of your financial stability. Think about your cash flows, right? Can you afford not to have a cash flow when something like this happens in the future? Think about your staff, who is rising to the challenge now and proving to be, you know, a very valuable resource, adapting very quickly, and who is not. Think about your old challenges. Which one of them are they still relevant, and which ones don't apply anymore? Think about what new challenges do you have today, you know? Think about what you should stop doing, right? This is a big one. What should you stop doing that you used to do before and now is not applicable anymore? Think about how you want to evolve the role of HR and how you want to start communicating more internally and externally. On a cultural level, think about the culture of your environment. Is your purpose clear, you know? Is your culture adaptive enough? Is your company resilient? Is your management and leadership style appropriate, and can you adapt them? Do you have discipline in your culture? Because in time of this, we need discipline, right? And this crisis, don't waste this opportunity. This crisis, as I said, is showing the best and the worst of us. This crisis is exposing to you what are the vulnerabilities of your business. So pay attention to this. Think about them, take notes, and think about them and what you want to do about that. Think about your strategy. Did you have a strategy? Is it still applicable? Think about if this is an opportunity for mergers and acquisitions, provided, of course, you have cash now. Right? If you have cash is king. If there's an opportunity to buy a company and to merge, maybe now is the time. Don't do it now, but at least start thinking about it and make yourself ready. Think about how you want to position yourself in the upcoming recession and how you position yourself in the upcoming recovery. And think about how do you focus on your core business, or should you go into other areas? In conclusion, and now coming into conclusion, and I'm sorry I troubled you with all of this, but it's really heavy stuff. So this is the conclusion. Life has changed, my friend. You can't be passive. We cannot be passive. Now it's time to do strategic work. This is not easy. We have to do strategic work. This is the hardest part of our work. Assume 12 to 18 months. Assume 12 to 18 months. Don't play it safe. Don't play it too optimistic. You'll never know. Consider that we are still under shock. We are still under the shock period. We're still recovering from the shock period. All everything that you have been seeing so far, it is just reaction to the shock. If you have WhatsApp, you know, people are just pouring their heart into WhatsApp because people are panicking. We're still dealing with the shock. So we're still under the shock period, right? We're not into denial. I think we're beyond denial, but we're into shock. And the sooner we go into acceptance, the better it is that we can act. We have to move into acceptance, because through acceptance, we can think strategically. Think about that we are now in a major survival battle on the personal level, on the family level, on the business level. We are at a survival level. So if you come out of this, if you can come out of this, you know, on your feet, you're a hero. This is a time for a mixture of compassion and responsibility. It's time for compassion with yourself, because this is so hard on you, especially if you have the burden of thinking about your organization, your team, what do you do, you know, people's livelihood, how you stay in business, you know, will this kill you? This is serious pressure. So be compassionate about yourself and manage yourself well in this compassion. Give yourself permission to feel tired and depressed and angry. Process all these emotions. This is also time to be compassionate about your colleagues and bosses. If your boss is angry, if your colleagues are angry, if whatever, your staff is depressed, this is the time for you to be compassionate with them, right? Because people, this is different for all of us. This is also the time for responsibility. It's the time to feel responsible. You need to be the strongest person in the team now so that you can inspire them. Otherwise, people will collapse. Of course, safety and security is first. Your mental sanity is absolutely important so that you can take the right decisions. Remember that it will take time to absorb this. Some of the things will change forever. Some of the things will stay normal. And some of the things will change, temporarily. So we'll continue in a change phase even for months and years to come. Business is very important. I know personal is very important. There's nothing more precious than life. But business is also important because in the end, it will sustain us even when we're healthy. So pay a lot of attention to your business. We are living into exceptional times. This is unique. It has never happened. Nowhere else, nowhere in our history books that we can go and learn from this. We're creating knowledge for future generation. So this is of this magnitude. Keep it in that perspective. This is the time to be a human being, right? Because it will show us the best and the worst for us. It's time to be a human. It's time to grieve. It's time to allow your feelings to come out. Express your feelings rather than suppress them, right? It's time to respect your emotions and your feelings and the emotions of others. It's time to find for meaning because battling, fighting for your organization to stay alive so that you don't fire people gives meaning. So this is also a time for meaning. My last point is that in the end, I believe it should be fine. We have survived hundreds of thousands of years. I think we can handle this with much less tools. We've survived, serious challenges. I am optimistic we will survive this. It will, so this will be fine in the end. And I feel this is important. We have a moral obligation for the sake of all of those who died, for the sake of all the pain, all the losses, all the jobs are being lost, for all of the sake of all what happened, is that for the sake of future generations, that we learn from this and that we create a better world. This is a moral obligation. We cannot allow all this damage on the human level, economic level, and the social level, and all what's coming to be wasted. This is a time, this is the promise of leadership. This is what being human should be all about.